just thought I'll do a quick little finish up of Hegel before we get into Deleuze's reading of Nietzsche. I was also thinking about two of the questions that I didn't really properly have answers for. I can't remember who asked them, but regarding Spinoza and regarding Sartre. Can you remember kind of the details of them? I think one of them was Spinoza's relation to Hegel on something like the absolute, but I can't recall. And the other one was Sartre. I remember it was being in nothingness and how they were related. Are we filming yet, or just out of curiosity? Are we filming? Oh, excellent. Okay. Right, okay. Yeah, I mean, there's a bit of a relationship, there's a bit of critique, and one way of thinking about it is the kind of 20th century interpretations of Hegel from Kojève and versus Hippolyte. One of them has to do with the reality of negation and whether negation is in the world or whether negation is only in consciousness. So being in nothingness, the idea is that the motor force of negation is not found in being but is found in consciousness. Consciousness negates being, and that's kind of the basis of freedom. That's kind of prefigured in Hippolyte, sorry, not in Hippolyte, in Kojève, in Kojève's idea that human history is the negation of being into a totality, which is the absolute. And that's why, for Kojève, human history is a realization of the absolute, of the identity of identity and difference. That's something that Hippolyte will challenge in the reading in Kojève's reading, and basically argue that it's a kind of humanism that Hegel himself wouldn't endorse. And so that's where the whole idea of being itself becomes nothing, nothing itself becomes being, right? I mean, the other one was Spinoza, I think it was about. Yeah, okay. Because I think it was something around the, because you mentioned knowledge or something, like knowledge. Okay.
Ideas and perspectives or on reality, on his own kind.
Yeah, I think the answer is reality, but then comes this whole kind of, but both are trying to think around the absolute. I mean,
Absolutely, yes.
that's and I mean Hegel's critique of Spinoza is that Spinoza can't think the absolute and therefore can't think the connection between the individual and the absolute because he doesn't think of it in terms of negation.
He kind of wants to bring reality to
Yeah, but yeah, I mean, both of them have a notion of the real as absolute. I mean, this is one of Hippolyte's reading of Hegel includes a critique of Spinoza for treating substance as pure production, as pure positive production without negation. And the claim is that, in a way, both Hegel and Spinoza are seeking a kind of immanence. They're seeking a kind of immanence where the principle of the absolute isn't transcended, it isn't separate from the world. But the Hippolyte Hegel critique of Spinoza is that he goes against his own principle of determination, all determination is negation, because he says a substance is purely positive and affirmative and so forth. Does that make sense? Okay. All right. So actually, I'll do this very quickly. I probably won't spend as much time up here today. So we were up to this in Hegel. I'm just going to very quickly run you through the end of it. Very, very quickly. So those are the fourth, titled the fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, and eighth chapters of the Phenomenology. We were in the dialectic of self-consciousness and beginning of the master-slave dialectic. As I mentioned, master-slave dialectic is only the beginning of this chapter, which is ultimately trying to determine the conditions under which self-consciousness is certain of itself, has a truth. And the end of that chapter, after going through several other stages, reaches the conclusion that self-consciousness is, I won't take you through all of the details, self-consciousness finds its truth in as much as the individual and the absolute, or the individual and the universal, are connected. Right? And that's something which is absent from the master-slave dialectic because, as we'll see later, the basis for that is going to be recognition. I'm part of the whole by virtue of the whole being a community, the whole being the state, by virtue of this kind of reciprocity we have with each other. But we're not at that stage yet. Self-consciousness famously ends with the section on titled Unhappy Consciousness. Unhappy consciousness is where the individual realizes that he has to, the certainty of his self-consciousness is based on a relation to the universal, but the universal is seen as the Christian God who is transcendent, who can never be reached, and so forth, who's a matter of faith, right? But it's that connection between the individual and the universal which leads on to the next chapter. The next chapter is the dialectic of reason. The idea is that that's what reason is. Reason is always concerned with the relationship between the individual and the universal, right? And that is a chapter which contains the most torturous part of the Phenomenology of Spirit, which is the section on observing reason, which is 60 pages or so of Hegel explaining that the connection between the individual and the universal is impossible it cannot be realized through self-consciousness. Relationship to the natural world. That whole point that I was saying yesterday, the natural world can be described but not known. There's no spiritual connection to anything in nature. That leads to the other side of it, which is that reason is realized, and reason as the relationship between the self and the universe, and the universal, not in our relationships to nature, but in our relationships in community, right? So that's what spirit is. Spirit is realized reason. Spirit is always community spirit. It's a living connection between the individual and the whole. And every community will have a spirit, right? So there will be a Greek spirit, a Roman spirit, so forth. Or what Hegel calls elsewhere a mode of consciousness, right? And then that's the next chapter. The next chapter is spirit. Spirit is the properly historical chapter, at least the first of the properly historical chapters, where Hegel will trace a history of lived spirits, a history of living communities, from the Greeks to the Romans through the Middle Ages, etc. The idea being that these communities had a connection made between the individual and the collective, right? But they all failed or contradicted themselves at some point. So none of these societies had true reciprocal recognition, for example, because they had slaves. Right, but history will be seen as a progression of spirit, right, through these various negations where different community spirits come in, realize their contradictions, they're replaced by others. We have a progression up to a state of history, right, a state of spirit, where we have the community of recognition, of reciprocal recognition, right? That's actually going to be the religious community. It's going to be a modern community. It's going to be what Hegel will think Prussia achieves in some way, right? So that's the historical chapter. It's by far the biggest chapter of the Phenomenology. The chapter on religion is a kind of parallel history of conceptions of the divine, which starts with ideas of divine forces in nature, to animal gods, to human gods, to a single god, and so forth, all of which suffer from the problem that there's a separation between the human and the divine, and in some cases a separation between the world and the divine, right? So that returns us to that problem of unhappy consciousness, that the Christian religion, which Hegel thinks of as a true religion, at least in its historical form, posits God as outside the world, right? And what Hegel will say is what's required is this kind of recognition or realization that our connection to the divine is actually not found in a God who's outside the world, it's found in our community. And really what the culmination of history is the divine coming to earth in the society of reciprocal recognition, where our self-consciousness is grounded, not in a relation to a transcendent being, but in our relationship to each other, to one another. Right? And then the final chapter is Absolute Knowing. It kind of traces the most recent philosophical steps taken from the philosophy of the subject, really from Descartes to Hegel himself. Right? And the idea is that history itself culminates with absolute knowing. The end of the phenomenology is meant to transfer into the logic. Right? The phenomenology is meant to be the first book of what was known as Hegel's early system, the system of science, that was never completed. Right? It included the phenomenology as the introduction, and then the science of logic as the big second book, but there was no philosophy of nature which came after that, right? Because then Hegel restructured everything. And that what we know of the encyclopedia, that's the later version, right, which starts with the logic, then nature, then spirit. Right? And so the phenomenology actually becomes a small part of the last part of the new system. Right? But you don't need to know those parts exactly. The claim in the phenomenology is a version of the same story. And I mean, Hegel, in many respects, says you could start the story from any of these points. You could start it from phenomenology. You could start it from logic, because they're each meant to transition into the others. And the phenomenology is meant to transition into logic. The end of the phenomenology is supposed to be the realization of the absolute. All right. Again, it's supposed to be realized in a certain respect politically with this notion of a community of reciprocal recognition, which in Hegel's political philosophy he will try and outline in the philosophy of right as what the structures are that create an ethical community. Right? Now, we'll get back to this at the, probably on the last day when we're discussing Hegel's politics of the state versus the Deleuze and Guattari's war machine idea. We'll probably talk more slave morality today. Does the slave morality? It does get a little bit of a mention in Deleuze in the War Machine Plateau. The discussion of work and subjectivity. An important point, and many people know, have made this comment about the structure of Hegel's thinking in general, but also the structure of the conclusion of the phenomenology and the transition into logic, and whether or not the transition is complete, right? Because the way in which Hegel will try and position everything is that there's an absolute, which is a notion or the concept of, in some sense, it's simply the identity of identity and difference. The worked out logic is the categories of being in essence and of the notion. That realizes itself in historical time, right? And so there's this idea that the logical notion becomes something in history, which itself, in a way, returns to the logic, right? But what really needs to be demonstrated in this is that history reaches its conclusion, right? In other words, it really comes down to whether this community of reciprocal recognition, whether Hegel can describe it accurately, whether it's coherent in itself, and so forth, because if it isn't, that there's always that gap which will remain, right, between the historical and between the absolute, and many people will identify that as the issue in Hegel, that there's a remaining gap in a sense between the phenomenology and the logic, between the historical and the logical, and so forth. For our purposes, based on what I was telling you before, a lot of the key things that happen after the dialectic of consciousness and before the master-slave dialectic all depend on this little statement Hegel makes that I mentioned before, but for us or in itself, the other of self-consciousness has a movement that self-consciousness cannot see. From for us or in itself, you're self-conscious and you have a relation to yourself that defines your self-conscious, which I can't see and you can't see mine. but we are relating self-consciousness to self-consciousness. And that assumption, that kind of claim that from some external position, everyone in kind of this scenario is self-conscious, but we haven't recognized each other yet. That's a crucial claim. It's off of that claim that Hegel really defines what desire is, his desire as recognition, right? And starts the entire process off. If we kind of reach the end of the story and that isn't realized, that isn't redeemed, all of the assertions that are made, all the assertions that are made to get the story going start to become problematic. All right? So, I mean, you know, as I said, for us isn't just any us. It's for us standing at the end of history, right? If we are in a society where we have achieved recognition, where we recognize our differences but also our commonality and our, you know, we have a spiritual connection, we can look back at our past, we can look back at the stories of our past, and we can say, well, those people just didn't know that they were self, they didn't know that they were relating one self-consciousness to the other, right? But that assumes we've achieved it, right? It assumes that history's reached its end, right, or its culmination. And if Hegel can't describe that culmination in a way that makes any sense, well, it's impossible to then assert, really, truthfully, that the relationship that was going on between people was a relationship of two self-consciousnesses which simply hadn't recognized themselves yet, recognized each other yet, right? The definition of desire is at stake in that. The whole idea of what the relations between these two entities are, and, you know, if they're not self-conscious, are they something else? Self-consciousness, in terms of that relation to self, might be a very poor way of understanding what a self is, right? And I mean, that's what Nietzsche would say in many respects. That's what Deleuze and Guattari actually say about the war machine, about the nomad. The nomad is criticized for being a primitive who lacks self-consciousness, but what he is a being that relates to his outside in a way that it's not really a model of the subject doesn't account for it, right? Anyway, I'll leave that with you for the moment. You might see some of that as we get into the reading of Nietzsche's kind of inversion or challenge to Hegel's idea of the master-slave dialectic with his own idea of noble and slave morality. So we'll get back to that, but that's in part where we're going, all right? And we'll get back to the whole recognition thing and the whole desire thing. We'll kind of update it through Lacan as well. Okay, so we're going now to Deleuze's book on Nietzsche, right, which is his second book, 1962. Keep always thinking that there's like the Kant book. I think the Little Kant book comes after. So it's Deleuze's second book. It's the book, as I think I mentioned before, that is heavily criticized as a book that is so polemical that it implies that Deleuze knows nothing about Hegel, because a key claim about the book is that Nietzsche is an anti-Hegelian, provides an absolute anti-Hegelianism. There is no possible reconciliation between Hegel and Nietzsche, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. All right? Deleuze sets Nietzsche up in a way as an absolute opposite to Hegel. And the standard Hegelian response to that is to say Deleuze, A, knows nothing about Hegel, Nietzsche knew nothing about Hegel. But B, it falls into the same trap which all the dialectician loves to use, to pull, right? Which is to say that if you say that something is the exact opposite of something else, it's dialectically related to that thing, right? So Nietzsche can't be somehow different from Hegel or somehow present something that's not already accounted for within a Hegelian circle, especially if you're going to say that Hegel, that Nietzsche is the polar opposite, the irreconcilable opposite of Hegel, right? So they accuse Deleuze of being a kind of naive reader, doesn't really understand that you can't set up B as the opposite of A without that already being a dialectical relationship. If it's a dialectical relationship, you can't say it's an irreconcilable relationship. dialectics is all about how what seems to be opposites negate their opposition. They're actually also related to each other. You couldn't have Hegel without Nietzsche. You couldn't have Nietzsche without Hegel. End of discussion. End of thing. All right? What will... These critics are wrong, by the way. If you kind of recognize what kind of Hegel Deleuze read, which was Hippolyte's reading of Hegel, right? If you also maybe put to one side some of the polemical language, you know, if you take it seriously, you can, I think, see that when Deleuze says that Hegel and Nietzsche are irreconcilable, there's a reason for that, and it doesn't fall into a dialectical trap. And that actually there's a very subtle critique of Hegel that's going on in the Nietzsche book, right? One which I mentioned before deals with the issue of force, right? Is in many respects a rethinking of the idea of force in Hegel's phenomenology in the third chapter that we discussed yesterday and that we'll get back to as well. We'll review a little bit in a few minutes. One of the things to keep in mind, and this is why some people will say it doesn't sound like a response to Hegel at all, is that Deleuze's language of forces seems very different from Hegel's description of force. But there's a reason behind that, which we'll discuss shortly. If you kind of understand the language itself doesn't seem to map onto Hegel's, there's a reason for that as well. All right? Has anybody read Nietzsche in philosophy? Can't remember if he said this, if we mentioned this. Great book. It was my introduction to Deleuze. I shouldn't say that. It wasn't my introduction to Deleuze. I had read, been assigned to read, understood pieces of the Rhizome essay and the War Machine essay when I was an undergraduate. But then this was the first Deleuze book I properly read, and it was useful because I knew Nietzsche. I knew some Nietzsche already. So if you know some Nietzsche, it's a very good way to get into Deleuze. Or anybody else. I mean, you mentioned Spinoza. If you know Spinoza well, read some of Deleuze's stuff on Spinoza, and it's a useful way of kind of seeing what he's doing, seeing what his own philosophy is based on, seeing what he's doing with a thinker that you know well. Right? Deleuze opens the Nietzsche book by saying that Nietzsche's most general project is the introduction of the concepts of sense and value into philosophy. And so those two terms are kind of key. Sense we discussed when I gave the keynote lecture, and I mentioned it briefly yesterday as well. Values, Deleuze will actually talk about first. So after talking about sense, you know, sense and values are the two things that Nietzsche wants to introduce into philosophy, he starts with values. You have your values, I have my values, whatever. Philosophy tries to ground values, what is good, what is evil, and so forth. Deleuze will make the argument that values presuppose evaluations. Right? We oftentimes think that we have our values first, and then we make judgments based on them, and those judgments are evaluations. I think this is good, I think that's evil, I look at this situation, I make my evaluation of it based on the values I already have. Deleuze will say that Nietzsche reverses this. He says values are based on evaluations, but he defines evaluations quite specifically as perspectives of appraisal. All right? And the perspectives is the important point. Evaluations are always perspectival evaluations from which our values arise. All right? These are evaluations in the sense of kind of pictures we have of the world. And every picture we have of the world is perspectival because it depends on where we are, right? And it's going to depend on who and what we are as well. That's why what Deleuze will say about Nietzsche is that we always have the values and the beliefs, the feelings that we deserve given our way of being and our style of life, he says. But a different way of saying it is given who and what we are. And who and what we are, again, is a matter of perspective, right? I talked a little bit two days ago about the difference between sense and truth, and that's an important one to keep in mind. We'll discuss more in a few minutes. But one of the things that opens up is a different notion of truth, which Deleuze will press through Nietzsche, which is perspectival truth, right? And as Deleuze will explain this really quite well, interestingly, in a much later book, in the book on Leibniz and the Fold, right? Perspectivism often gets confused with relativism, which is incorrect, right? Relativism, aside from being a kind of just knee-jerk critique of anyone who considers themselves a universalist, right? The universalist likes to accuse everyone who doesn't, who questions universality as being a relativist. Relativism is usually a derogatory term which asserts a kind of subjectivity to someone else's position. The relativist isn't the person who's... The relativist would be the person who says, this is good for me. I think this is good. You think that's good, right? My culture thinks this is good. Your culture thinks that's good. There's no mediating, overarching set of standards, right? But it's a very subject-oriented kind of thing. It's what I choose it to be. The truth is what I kind of hold it to be. Truth might be is what I choose to be, choose it to be. Perspectivism is different. Perspectivism is about truths that aren't chosen, but which you cannot help but have. All right? So a good way of describing it is, we stand on the surface of the earth, and we look up in the sky, and the sun and the moon look like they are the same size, right? When you see them both in the sky together, or even if you see them separately, the sun and the moon look like they're the same size. This doesn't mean they are necessarily the same size, nor does it mean we could ever get into a perspective where we would see the difference, see what their, quote, actual sizes are, right? It means instead that from where we're standing on the earth, they look like they're the same size, and they have to look like they're the same size. It couldn't look any different, all right? And that's what perspectivism entails. Like, a different one is if you're in a city and you see two really tall buildings that look like they're the same height, until you walk, kind of closer or walk properly in between them, and then you realize one is a lot bigger than the other, right? It depends on where you are, is what you see. Now, the thing is that Deleuze will say there is a perspectivism of truth, right? The truth of perspectivism is kind of this perspectivism of truth, whereas relativism suggests that subjects, in some sense, hold values. Perspectivism, or hold truth, perspectivism suggests that these perspectives constitute the subject, all right? You are what you are because your place in the world shows you a world, and you can't help but seeing it otherwise, all right? So like a different way of thinking about this is, our subjectivity is constituted by our perspective. It's constituted by the fact that we are on the Earth's surface looking up at the sky. It gives us a vision of the cosmos, which would have been completely different if we were out in a spaceship or somewhere else, all right? If you're in the countryside, if you're away from city lights, and you look up at the sky, what does it look like?
Clear blue hues.
Yeah?
Clear blue hues.
Yeah, and? It looks at, sorry?
Night sky.
Yeah, if you look at the night sky.
Starry, more
starry. But it's kind of more than that. It looks like a big dome. It looks like a big dome. Like the Greeks, who had this crazy idea, which we think is crazy. It wasn't stupid, because this is the way the universe looks. It's the way the cosmos looks from the Earth. It looks like a big dome, and it has like holes punched in it, and lights shine through it. And if you sit there and you watch the night sky, it seems like the entire dome is moving. Except you realize that some of the points of light aren't moving uniformly. Like many of them are moving uniformly across the sky, but others aren't. So maybe there's a different dome carrying the other light. The other light is somehow shining through, and it's moving in a different way. The ancients, I can't remember which one, is an Egyptian? I think it's Ptolemy. They played around with how many different spheres must make up the cosmos, given that, the planets move in a different arc than the background stars. Than other things. I think Ptolemy, it's like 56. Like there's some crazy way they came up with, like there must be 56 separate shells moving slightly differently. But that's the way the world, that's the way, it seems crazy to us, but that's the way things look, right? You know, another important thing is precisely because it looks like it's these other things that are moving around the Earth, it's quite easy to think that the Earth is the center, which is what everyone thought, right? They didn't think that it was the Earth moving around the Sun. They thought it was the Sun moving around the Earth. So, I mean, if you think about it, our subjectivity in the sense of our culture, our beliefs, our values, in part emerge from literally our physical position in the universe, on a planet, looking up at the sky, seeing what we see. And we couldn't help but see it that way. Right? So this is the point. Perspectives create subjectivities. Where you are determines how you evaluate things, because it determines what you see, and your values follow from that. And Nietzsche himself will talk about this. His whole critique of a morality is that morality is perspectival. Right? The morality of good and evil, Nietzsche says, will come from a perspective that is lowly and base, and that looks up at other things that are more powerful than it. And we'll get into this in a little bit. But he refers to it as some values, Nietzsche says, especially what he talks about the metaphysical values of that are opposites, the belief in opposite values, comes from a lowly, pathetic, frog-like perspective, right? Which he's going to say is the perspective of the weak, right? So perspectivism means it's not you don't choose your perspective, and your perspective makes you. Your values follow from your perspective. Your evaluations are your perspectives of, or perspectives of appraisal, right? The genealogy for Nietzsche is going to be an analysis of these perspectives, the origin of our values and the perspectives that make us what we are.
What doesn't kill me makes me stronger.
Yeah?
Values derived from your perspective.
Possibly, yeah. I think that kind of has a slightly different place in Nietzsche's thinking, but yeah, I think it's relevant as well. From a certain perspective, you think that what doesn't kill you could still be horrible and has no value,
yeah,
right?
Then you eliminate that.
Yeah. 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 I think the point is that however you face it, yeah. Maybe. It depends. Well, I mean, I could give you examples of people and experiences you probably had too, because we all have them, where something injured you but didn't kill you, and all you can think about was how unfair it was that you were injured in the first place. So, I mean, like, it depends what, it comes out of, it depends, is the point.
So, is he talking about killing you as in losing your life, or killing you as in losing your perception or your understanding of the truth?
It depends. By the way, I should say,
is it metaphorical or is it like?
It could be either. I mean, I actually should correct you on one thing, because whether Nietzsche is actually endorsing that statement, you actually haven't quoted the full statement. Nobody ever does. It's from the military school of life, what does not kill me makes me stronger.
Mm-hmm.
So, it's from a certain way of thinking. And whether Nietzsche, Nietzsche endorses in a way a kind of noble warrior mentality, whether he even thinks that mentality is the same thing as the military school of life, I don't know. But I mean, I can tell you it is true that certain things that don't kill you do make you stronger, but whether it really makes you stronger or not also depends on who and what you are. Because some things that don't kill people just make them resentful of the fact that they had to endure them in the first place. So, that's, yeah. This will make sense later. I think it will make sense later. Yeah. Okay? Yeah. Sure.
If perspectives create subjectivities, and
yeah.
Our perspectives depend on our context,
yeah.
Is there any possibility that we can overcome the context? And
maybe. One of Nietzsche's challenges, he even asks, is can we find a way to think around our own corner? I think that's the way it's in the phrase goes. But, literally get outside of our own perspective to kind of see the different perspective, right? And, one of Nietzsche's tasks is to show that that's that it is that there have to be other perspectives. So like his critique of morality is always a critique that our morality comes from this perspective. But the thing about perspectives is they're always partial, right? So I have a perspective on the city, and you standing over there have a perspective on, you know, you have a, maybe have a, see a completely different city. You might be looking at the same city, right? But have a completely different perspective on it, right? So, and it's because, but the point is that every perspective implies that there must be other perspectives, because a perspective is, to assert that things are perspectival means that there's no God's eye view. Right, there's no Archimedean point. An Archimedean point is a perspectiveless view. Right. So yeah, I mean that's the open question: is could we determine and either know or feel or come to terms with or get a handle on a perspective other than the perspective we seem to have because of where we are.
Right. What I see is that there is a critique of universalism.
Yeah, this is part of the critique of universalism, okay? But this is values. We have to get to sense, by the way. And that's why, like, it's one of my favorite lines of Nietzsche in philosophy is the end of the first page. We all have the beliefs, feelings, and values that we deserve given our way of being and our style of life, which a different way, a sort of simpler way of putting it is we all think what we're supposed to think given who and what we are, right? And in some ways, it's not a choice. It has to do with, it's easier to see it with other people than necessarily to see it with yourself. But we all know people who think crazy things sometimes or really annoy, well, friends of ours, right? You have friends who have, do annoying things or have annoying habits or annoying beliefs. And sometimes you look and you just, but that's just who they are. That's just the way they're made, is that they're made to be this kind of person, all right? And like you either accept them as your friend or you don't, but you recognize that it kind of comes out of where they are in the world, so to speak, and how the world made them into that, as opposed to something else. Nietzsche will always say it's a great resentment to hold that somebody should be otherwise than as they are, to say that man should be different. Man is this way. Man should be something else. And what he'll say is, everybody is formed not just within a perspective, but a perspective within a whole, right? To say that you want someone else to be different means you actually want the entire world to be different, right? You want the entire world to be different so that they were formed differently, and that's the great arrogance. He says it's the great arrogance of the moral man is to think that because man should be something different, in saying man should be something different, he's saying the universe should be different, right? Etc. We'll see. We'll get back to that point actually, a little bit later. Okay. So we've got values and we've got sense. Sense, I mentioned before, in the keynote. Sense involves a physical, involves ideas of the physical, the conceptual, and directional. All right. So physical senses, sense of sight, sense of touch. The concept of sense will involve those. The conceptual, sense as meaningfulness, the sense of a word, the sense of a concept. Sense as direction, right? And in Nietzsche, sense will always be related to a becoming of some sort, to a becoming in a certain direction. Becoming, by the way, isn't the same thing as a movement. It's not the same thing as a change. And it's a very subtle thing. Many becomings, Nietzsche will say, take place without going anywhere, so to speak, right? But sense will involve all of those. We can think of sense as the physical, conceptual, and directional brought together in an expression of a becoming. All right. This expression, Deleuze will say, is a matter of an art of interpretation, which is distinct from an assessment of facts. So sense is something, he says, is a matter of a philosophical art. Sense isn't found by studying the facts of the matter. It's not. It's either not empirical, or it's just kind of superior empiricism, a different kind of empiricism, one that's not about recording the facts, but about including interpretation into the way in which we engage with the empirical world. All right, and that's why we'll always be tricky. You need to be smart about it. You need to interpret things because the facts may say one thing, but they may, the sense of a situation may be something else. And the example that Nietzsche will give, that Deleuze will give in this respect, when he talks about noble and slave moralities, right, his version in a way of the master-slave dialectic, but Deleuze's whole point is it's not the master-slave dialectic, is that the slaves can be victorious. Their morality can come to dominate the world, and it doesn't make them masters. Right? Winning, the fact of winning, doesn't change the sense of them as being slavish, resentful, and the like. Right? So sense is different from the facts of the matter. Completely different factual situations could have the same sense. Right? Or the same factual situation could have different senses, could have different meanings. In fact, that will also be the point, that every event has multiple senses, multiple meanings. Because it usually involves a clash of or struggle amongst perspectives, right? Okay. The last point to make here, and we'll get back to it in a little bit later, a bit more detail, is the will to power, right? Which is one of the two key terms that Deleuze discusses. I mean, it's not the only thing he discusses in the book, but the will to power and the eternal return are kind of the two central ideas he wants to, his analysis of Nietzsche revolves around, and in particular, his claim that they are compatible in some way, that the will to power and the eternal return follow from each other. Because many interpreters will say that they're incompatible with each other. The whole idea of the eternal return, the whole idea of the will to power, are not, they don't fit together. But Deleuze will say they do. The will to power, the way Deleuze will say they fit together, actually, I had the word eternal return here too. I should have read my notes properly. The will to power expresses sense, all right, that expressive becoming, that directional becoming, whereas the eternal return is the sense of sense or the structure of sense. And in a way, you could say the eternal return is the structure of becoming, which is why we'll discuss this more tomorrow than today. It's related to the structure of time, right? As you've heard of the three syntheses of time in Deleuze's thought, maybe if you haven't even read Difference and Repetition, but it's talked about in all the secondary literature. This is what Saswat said I have to explain to you. You're all going to want to know what the three syntheses are, and especially the third synthesis. Deleuze links the third synthesis to the eternal return, right? And he'll speak of the structure of time. The structure of time is a structure of eternal return. I'll just say that today. I'll try and explain it more really tomorrow, at the end of today and tomorrow. But just keep that in mind. Will to power expresses sense. Eternal return is the sense of that sense, or the structure of that sense, and hence the structure of becoming. Right? Another thing that Deleuze will say about the eternal return is it's the guarantor of novelty and creation and change. It's because time is structured as eternal return that something new emerges into the world. Which is why it's also related to will to power, because that's how overcoming, which would be something new, can emerge in the world. Yeah? Yeah. Well, I'm just setting it out now. The elaboration, we'll get back to it. So I won't elaborate it now, because that would be getting me ahead of the structure of the way I want to, of what I'm going to tell you. All right? But hopefully it will be elaborated and it'll make sense in the next 2 days. And if it doesn't, well, it's all being recorded, so you can go back and watch it over and over and over again. Okay, let's go back to Hegel and that whole idea of force, right? Remember, we had the thing of sense certainty, that it turned out that when I'm sensing things immediately, I'm not really just sensing them, I'm perceiving them as objects. And then came the question of what is an object? An object with this contradictory, sometimes an object was a contradictory union, in the sense of unity and multiplicity. The object was supposed to be a single thing, and yet it was also related to all other things. The concept of force is meant to be, to encompass that dual movement, right? So force represents, for Hegel, something dynamic, right? And the point is that force, you know, it comes in the third chapter called Force and the Understanding. Force is something that can be understood, but it's not something that's sensed or perceived, all right? But it makes sense and perception possible, right? It provides their condition of possibility. And really, for Hegel, what that means is they provide the condition of possibility for judgment. That is to say, for what we sense and perceive to have identity and to have consistency and to have a truth attached to it. All right? What is judgment? Judgment is a structure statement. The structure of judgment is always the predication of a subject. X is Y. That's the way Aristotle defines it. Sorry? I mean, but it goes back to Aristotle. You know, Aristotle defines judgment that way. Kant defines it that way, too. The idea of judgment, as Kant himself will say, as Hegel will say, contains an apparent contradiction in it. So if I say this chair is red, the problem is kind of is a grammatical problem, if nothing else, which is that the chair is more than red or different from red. I'm attaching red onto it as though from the outside, because I'm treating it as a property. So I'm treating red as something the chair has rather than what the chair is, right? And to say that the chair is red is already to speak about it in a way that's different from speaking of it as a chair. If I say a chair is a chair. Like 2 minutes? Okay. So a chair is a chair, right? That's an analytical statement that has no meaning, that has no value, not very much of the truth value. It has no truth value, it's a truism, all right? The problem of judgment is that when I say the chair is red, there has to be a way in which the chair goes outside of itself so that redness attaches to it, all right? While nonetheless, the statement only refers to the chair. It refers to itself alone. So there needs to be this kind of individuation and connection, right? That's implied by the very structure of judgment, right? The whole idea about of force in Hegel is that it is that if we stop thinking about these things as objects, we start thinking of them as forces, we see how they both go through a process of being being opposed to each other and being connected to each other, right? And that's a dynamic, I think I mentioned it before, is the dynamic of a being in itself becoming a being for another, and becoming a being for itself through others, all right? We never see this dynamic. You never sense the way in which the objects of the world relate to each other and connect to each other and then return to a unity. All right? We can understand it, all right? We can treat it as a convention, as I mentioned a couple of days ago, right, in the keynote. All right? But it provides a synthesis that makes judgment possible. All right? So in order to, you know, what's kind of presupposed, what needs to happen for me to say the chair is red, even though I'm still talking about just the chair, and I'm not talking about other things, right, is for this kind of separation and connection to be going on, literally behind the scenes. And this concept of force is what kind of carries out that idea, right? We don't see and we don't perceive it, but it makes possible our judgments, right? And so, I mean, it makes possible our judgments so that our judgments make sense, right? In a literal sense, the play of this dynamic of forces in Hegel, this kind of opposition and return, is literally what, according to Hegel, allows experience to make sense. By making sense, he means we can make judgments, right? Deleuze has a different notion of what making sense is, right? And he will oppose the model of judgment. He'll also, for that reason, oppose this notion of what the relation is that we're presupposing when we're asking how things make sense, how experience makes sense, right? What will be central to Deleuze's claim is that we have to understand, we can't think about things as things, we can't think about them as objects, we do have to think about them as relational, but if we think about them as relational in the form of an opposition, where they are separate from each other and connected to each other and separate from each other and connected to each other, they oppose each other in these kinds of two senses, we have an abstract understanding of what this dynamic is. It's an abstract formulation, right? We'll take the coffee break in a second, but that's going to be Deleuze's key claim, and in a way it's Nietzsche's claim as well. As soon as Nietzsche says that opposites are perspectival, they come from base perspectives, is that opposition is an abstraction. Right, to think of the dynamic of forces as a dynamic of opposition is to think about them abstractly rather than concretely. We'll pick it up there after we have a coffee break.